Well, people, welcome to episode 47 of the Where's Brunch podcast. Hey.
Hello.
Took a little week off.
Hey.
Back in the building.
We are back.
What's good, baby?
Nothing much. You know, a little injured reserve, but I'm good.
Yeah, we both had some. you got the JV team in right now because we've both been on the bench.
Yeah, we've been on the bench. I literally had to go to the doctor because I was in so much pain. You know how you try to get back on track?
Yeah, man.
And then the curveball comes. Yo. So I'm officially on the bench at least for 2 weeks until I do a follow-up appointment with my doctor.
It was crazy, man. Listen, like, every time you try to unbig the back, you know what, man? It's time for the drink. I need a drink today. Yeah,
it's
for
a setup.
Sure.
It's a setup to keep
me. It's thick. All a setup.
To keep me thick.
Cheers. Cheers. Cheers.
We are drinking sparkling Shiraz. I guess kind of like a nice, deep, dark, smoky in celebration of Halloween that's coming.
Oh, is that what it is? You got the lipstick to match it. Look at you.
I'm vampy.
See what you're doing.
I'm a little vampy today.
The vamp life. You don't usually hear me saying I need a drink, but today I'm like, you know what, it's time. Yeah, let's pour it up today. Let's pour it up.
That's why when you said, are you making the pizza? I was like, shit.
No, we're not making the pizzas today.
I don't feel like doing that
shit. Maybe we'll do breakfast pizzas tomorrow, though.
Hey, you want a little bit more of my breakfast pizza, boo?
Breakfast pizzas on that beef bacon. Yo, how, we both, you know, I had my back, yo.
Yeah.
I had a week. I said, all right, boom, it's time. Mm-hmm. I'm over this. I'm tired of being, you know what I'm saying, the chub rock over here. It's time to get things together. And I had a good, you know what I'm saying, couple workouts, right? Mm-hmm. We do HIIT workouts,
yes.
Right? High interval training for those who don't know. Yeah, I was in here with the bands and all that. You know what I'm saying? Got a good, you know what I'm saying, workout. And then, all right, you know, getting back to it again next day, whatever it was. Mm-hmm. Stretch like I usually do.
Mm-hmm.
I stretch, pause, yes. And I'm in here stretching, and I stretched in a way to, you know, stretch my back out a little bit, and something said, nah, fam. I'm not sure what you thought this was, but as a matter of fact, go ahead and sit down for a couple weeks.
Yeah.
And my back has been killing me on the right hand side.
And you even went and got a massage.
I went and got a massage, which helped. It hasn't been as prevalent, but it's still. If I move the wrong way, it's a wrap.
Yeah.
It's like it's on the brink of being something really devastating.
Yeah.
And so yeah, the pain's been crazy. You see me walking around here?
Yes.
Hobbled, bent over, paused, and then it starts hurting my hips.
Yeah.
Because I'm compensating.
And
yes. My hip started burning and hurting on the right side the other day, so you know. And then
me,
you,
I decide, okay, Trina, listen, we gotta get this. Summer bodies are made in the winter. It is time. So I figured we're gonna start off low and slow with walking on the treadmill.
Mm-hmm.
Get up 6 a.m a few days in a row. The first day my Apple Watch did not record the whole workout, and I was salty about that. I was real mad because I walked a mile, and I was on there for like 45 minutes, and it only recorded like 25 minutes
of the
walk. For some reason. Mm. And I read an Apple Watch, Apple stuff, that sometimes the watch does not record your entire workout. So the last time, the other day.
My Samsung watch doesn't do that.
Ain't nobody asked. So this time I decided, okay, I'm going to do the Apple treadmill workout. This way, it's got to record me. And the Apple treadmill workout, you can either do the walk or the run. Shout out to them. The playlist was crazy. It was hip hop. We talking Public Enemy, KRS, Joe Budden, Salt and Pepper, Big Daddy Kane,
Eminem,
Rakim. We went 80s, 90s, 2000s. And I was shocked that this was on Apple's playlist. But a 45-minute treadmill walk, it consisted of increasing the speeds, but no more than a 5. And increasing the incline, no more than a 3. Mm-hmm. So I'm feeling like I'm doing good. There's a good sweat going. All of these things are happening. It recorded. I closed rings that day. It was a hell of a day. I accomplished things. came back upstairs after the workout, sat down, had to take Beans to the vet for his allergy shot. And when I got out the car to go get Beans, something about the way I squatted or whatever, and pain.
Bang.
Pain, left groin area. Get him inside. They take his weight. They take him to the back. She hands me a clipboard to update any of Beans' information. Sit down on a bench. Go to get back up to walk the clipboard over. Complete and utter pain.
Your body said, nah, like fam.
My body said, nah, fam. Mm. It said, bitch, you tripping. And my whole groin area like gave out. And I was just like, oh. And the lady said, are you okay? And I said, I don't think so.
I don't think so.
And so I spent that day, that was Wednesday, in pain. And that night, it was progressing. It was bad. I took the pain med, which is like an anti-inflammatory pain med, and it did nothing the whole night. I was sleeping. I was moaning in my sleep. It was hurting so bad.
Yeah, your sleep was interrupted. I mean, I was out. But
you were out, but I was in pain. No matter what way, flat on my back. On the opposite side, the pain was radiating through. Then I turned on that side. I was like, well, fuck it. You know, it's
hurting. So the crazy part about the timing of your leg is that just a couple nights before that, I smacked it up, flipped it, and rubbed it down.
You did. Yeah. You did. And I was trying to get it again. This, I was like, oh, that was so good. I'm going to get that again.
Meanwhile, I had my knees taped up. You know what I'm saying? Get some rest. This Negro talking about.
Nah. We got to do that again, man. Like, huh? That was some serious, like.
I gave you the Bell Biv DeVoe.
Woo! Oh, no. Yes.
So, yeah. And then ever since then, you've been
on the bench.
It's been some nonsense, straight up.
So, went to the doctor yesterday in the morning, and she's just like, oh, we need to rule out that you don't have a hernia.
Mm.
She moved it to the left. She moved it to a certain point. Ow. She moved it to the right. Certain point. Ow. She moved it down. Ow. She tried to move it up. No. Wasn't doing it. We're not throwing a leg up. It's not happening. And she was just like, don't lift anything. Don't move anything. Don't carry anything. You cannot work out. Do not try to stretch this out, because she knows about my yoga situation. Yoga stretching is not going to help. This is going to actually make this worse. You need to sit down for 2 weeks, and we need you to come back, because my blood pressure was elevated, but they think it was related to the pain.
Let me shout out to the doc. Let me say something to the doctors out there.
Yeah.
If you don't tell my wife specifically that you cannot have sex, she is going to drag her lower half of her body into this house on her hands. Legs just dragging, trying to jump on me.
I mean, I feel like if I could turn to the side.
I'm not into that. I'm not the limp body thing. Is that
if I can turn to the side, it all work. Okay.
Yo, that's hilarious, man. Y'all got to give specific instructions, because this one right here is wild. Because
everything still works. Everything still works.
And you know how I get when you're not feeling.
You
well.
Will not touch me. Oh my God. You turn into like, oh my gosh. You need to get a bed. You need to go get in. You need to lay it down. You need to relax.
Health is first, man. It's the most important thing. Like, I make sure my baby's good.
Come on.
We can do this. No, we cannot. You coughing from the bottom of your feet.
If it still works, you can still do it.
If you contract coughing like that, do I need to say anything else, guys? I don't want to get too graphic. That's not good.
Listen.
Man.
Here we are.
Here we are, yo. And we're shooting on, we're shooting a day early.
Yep.
So the energy is a little different, but it still feels good, though.
It feels good. It feels like we, today, with the day ending kind of early for us and stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm coming off the drugs, kind of, sort of. So I feel like, okay, it's all good.
Yeah, we have our, we're shooting a day early so we can still put this out for you guys on Monday. Mm-hmm. But tomorrow, the day we usually shoot, we have our first live podcast and wine tasting.
And wine tasting. Copious amounts of wine. All the bottles.
Yeah, Jess is wild, yo. She's ready to go.
And there's a Magnum Bill Card champagne that we got to pay half on with her for the event.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're hearing this and you didn't go, it's too late. But there will be more.
There will be.
And you know what I'm saying? Hopefully there'll be more. I'm looking forward to it.
We're going to do it big. It's going to be great.
Yeah, it's going to be dope.
It's going to be fun because there are going to be people there. And I'm excited to meet people who listen.
Yes, yes.
You know?
And hopefully get some new followers, new listeners.
Yeah.
And just really just have a good time.
Yeah.
Interact. The tickets, we didn't sell, it's free.
Yeah.
The tickets, quote unquote, sold out in a day and a half, right? It was they're gone.
It was very fast.
It was a day, pretty much. Yes.
Which is great.
And then, you know, we maintained a list that added, you know, a few more people on there.
Yeah.
It's going to be fun, yo. We're going to talk about sex and relationships. We have a special guest coming on the show.
Hey!
Yeah!
We don't get a guest. We call people.
We've called people. We do have a little bit of a setup for our guests here.
Yeah.
But we'll get there. Yeah, so we have our first actually on the set guest tomorrow. So we will be putting it out. Definitely on YouTube. Mm-hmm. It's definitely gonna be a visual experience.
Mm-hmm.
Possibly audio, depending. It is live.
Yeah.
People are gonna be all over the place.
I hear glasses clinking.
Clinking, talking, laughing. So maybe audio. Maybe. But we'll see.
We'll see.
You looking forward to it?
I'm very excited. And we're gonna have a producer too. We got somebody producing.
Tune the Fork, yo. Shout out to Tune the Fork, yo. Shout out to my man James.
Yes.
Right there.
So excited. So excited for James to produce us. This is gonna be fun.
Yeah, it is gonna be fun.
It's really gonna be fun. Excited to see folks. Excited to do this. Have a guest and have a different environment for us to shoot the pod.
Yes, yes, yes. That's gonna be a dope situation. And we hopefully will be doing this quarterly.
Hopefully,
so that's the goal. So with the next one, the last quarter starts in November.
Yeah.
And the way she's talking, she wants to get another one on the books quick. So we'll see.
So if you missed this one, stay tuned. We announce the next one so that you can be in attendance.
Yeah, man.
They already got the charcuterie board together and all the wine. And then you can buy wine by the glass as well as buying bottles of if you drink something that you really, really like, as well as anything else in the store. So like the olive oil,
for sale.
The cheeses, the meats, they got chilled wine in there. They've got regular wine. They got chocolate.
What's the slush? The slushies, right?
They got the slushies. So they got a rum apple cider slushy. And then they have The froze
is delicious.
Styrofoam cups, y'all. Y'all seen us when we've had them on this show.
I know I'm gonna have one there. Yeah, I think that's gonna be the drink of choice.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to be careful with this episode with the the build up because you know Jess is ready to pop bottles.
Yes.
So we can't go into the episode already tipsy.
She told me she was gonna be drinking all day.
She is gonna be
She was trying to figure out the food ordering
situation. Oh really?
Because what's the guy's name that's doing the wine?
I think it's
Chris. Yeah, Chris wants a particular thing, and so they're trying to figure out how to get it to the store. Coco Loco or one of the Peruvian chicken places.
Okay,
that he wants. That's just for them.
Puerto Rico.
I don't remember.
Okay,
she said the name. But she was talking to me about that the other night.
See, it's a whole secret conversations going on. I don't even know everything that's happening. I know is that we're going to be
there. I did see the wines. I saw all five of them. And I was like,
I haven't seen the wines yet.
This is serious.
It's serious?
Uh-huh.
The wine tasting is going to be nuts.
The wine tasting is going to be crazy.
She sent you a picture of it?
No, we walked the store. She showed me.
Oh, okay. Y'all should have took a picture. We could have posted that. That would have been good to post for everybody to see.
Huh. We can take the picture when, before it starts.
I'm just saying it would have been good. Yeah, that's all right. Lessons learned. Lessons learned. Next time we will really lure them in even more, folks, with the
also
pictures.
One of the bottles is not in a store yet. It's not. It hasn't arrived yet. They agreed on it. It just wasn't in the store.
So it looked like a serious lineup.
Five
joints.
Five.
Oh, it's gonna be crazy, y'all. Five. It's gonna be crazy, y'all. Yo, shout out to Unwind.
Shout out to Unwind.
Shout out to Jess.
We're excited. Vanessa, Jess, Nikki.
Yeah, it's gonna be a good show.
And Brett on the Rebel side also.
Oh yes, Nikki and Brett, love them.
Love them.
Love them. You know.
And I'm like halfway an employee there now, so
you know. No, you in. You're an employee. Yeah, you're an employee. Shout out to you, yo. Oh yeah, that's a thing. Hold on, man. Let's reset this. Kid. We gotta go into that a little bit. So yeah, you have so you attempted in the past to get a wine gig going that didn't really work out, and you are back at it now. Well, tell the people what's going on.
I am working, I guess, as a sales associate at Unwind.
Hey. Love it. I
don't know my schedule yet, but yes, I am working there. So for those of you who want to shop and get some wine and you want to see me in action and get some recommendations of some of my faves in the store, because as we walked the store, we realized that I drank a lot of wine.
I had this.
I can kick you a couple of regions back and you might find something that you like. So yes, it's something that helps me in learning the business of wine to better understand things. I have worked in wine shops before. I worked in Florida in the wine cellar. And I worked in D.C. at another place doing tasting experiences. So I probably will work on a tasting experience at the shop.
Yeah.
that's on the list of things to do. But it'll just be fun to get some more exposure to some more wines, learn about some more grapes, learn about different, you know, varietals and regions and stuff.
Just immersing yourself in the wine.
Absolutely. That's and dope. Learning about, you know, the retail side, because we have a business plan and that's moving.
I am so ready to push. I'm over here. I want to say something so bad, but we cannot say it.
But we have a business plan moving.
But just know that on the other side of the pod tomorrow, it is time to
go.
Yes. Yeah. That's where my mind is, at least.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's dope. And that's I'm happy for you.
Thank you. Everyone is so supportive and welcoming at Unwind. Mm-hmm. Shout out to my therapist.
I mean, we're already family over there.
But shout out to my therapist for pushing me, who told me I should have been doing this like 6 months ago.
Shout out to her, yeah. Listen, I've been working on it. You know what I'm saying?
Look,
I was just about to say that word. I am very gentle when it comes to my baby. So I want to push her and encourage her, but I don't want to beat her down. You know what I mean? So it's a process. So we got there. And I'm not saying this has been difficult at all.
No,
it's just a matter of timing and stuff like that.
Timing. So the timing is now.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, outside of the injury. The timing is not. It's a good look, yo. It's really good. So if y'all are in the DMV, if you live in the DMV or you're visiting the DMV, especially on the Virginia side, but it was right across the bridge on top of
it's
that.
It's really right by the Woodrow Wilson Bridge.
It's right, there. And visit Unwind and come see Trina.
And
come get some wine.
There are some great wines there. There's some Brown Estate there. There's some Phil Long wines. If you're looking for black winemakers, there's an amazing champagne selection. They've got a whole cheese section in the back that I don't eat cheese, but there's a lot of cheese back there.
They have Sin Nudes and Sexual Chocolate there.
They have Sin Nudes and Sexual Chocolate.
What's my man? Slow Wine.
Slow Down Wines.
It's my guy.
Yep. There's a lot of good stuff in there. So
and they have Chook in there now because of us.
They have the Chook in there.
Good job on that. Yeah.
Hey. They've got Bill Cart in there on They've got Greek wine.
Well, you should be saying we've got. Oh, yes. Look at that. Hey, more applause for that.
So, yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm excited to just, you know, it's good to be in the wine space. It's really good. As I just try to figure out, you know, my footing and what to do and where I belong and stuff, it's really good.
No doubt. Yeah. So, that was nice. That was a nice little was that an introduction that we just kind of had to talk about?
Yeah.
We had things to get off our chest.
Yeah.
There's more.
Yeah.
So let's talk about this. I wrote up on the board a few days ago, social media fatigue.
And I instantly was like, ooh, yes.
So let me play something real quick that's going to kind of give a basis of where I'm coming from with this.
This feeling of embarrassment, this shyness, this bashfulness. If you take that out of the people, then these people will do whatever they want to do. And that is the very definition of America, a people who have no shame, and therefore they do whatever they want to do.
That is a clip of my ex-father-in-law, who is a man that I revere.
Oh, because I was about to say, well, who?
And it was actually clipped and used on a Tribe Called Quest album back in 96. The speech itself is older than that.
Okay.
But, man, did he not foresee something? Like, if you think about what he said there and where the internet, the social media, Instagram specifically, is right now. I'm tired.
I mean, everybody wants to go viral. Everybody wants to... I don't know if people equate going viral with making money, but a lot of the people who are making money on social media will tell you that they're not making that much money.
Right. That's true, too.
Like, for the clicks and the virality, I don't know what you call it, going viral. The clicks and things that happen from that, they're not making that much money off of. You could have 85 million people like, comment, share, play, whatever your thing, and you only get, like, $800 from it. Something like that.
You know, we were there when the internet came and turned into a thing, right? Yes. We were there, right? We were
Al Gore's internet.
19 or so.
Yeah, 1995, 1996.
Yeah, 95. It's everything is so everything is so scripted out there now.
Okay.
Right? And everyone has a voice.
Absolutely.
And a microphone and a way to put it out.
Yeah.
And it's overwhelming.
I would say background. Let me give you background. With me and the environment in which I work in, it was always frowned upon to do any sort of social media, anything, for the fear of losing your job, for the fear of possibly having to answer for it, a possible suspension of clearance, whatever. I work in the federal government. I was definitely skeptical about anything on doing anything online.
Yeah.
Just because of that.
They discourage it. They put
the fear. I remember in 2009 being terrified, like, I'm never getting on Facebook.
Right.
I'm never going to do it. And then I did it. And I was just like, oh, my family's on here. Okay, well, I could just share, you know, pictures and update them on the kids and everybody can see stuff. But when it became this Instagram, Snapchat, TikTok, all of these things, it became a different beast.
Yeah.
And as COVID happened and people were throwing their entire lives and their experiences, but I mean,
they were living their experiences live
through social media. I mean, and then, you know, rewind before COVID, people were still throwing their lives on there. You would see stuff and you'd be like, why in the world would they put that out?
Like, major fails.
Yeah.
And you still put it out.
And you put it out.
Like he said, there's no shame.
There isn't. And when you look at generation, well, what's this? These millennials, what are these people? I don't know. But these people, they have like a culture of overshare.
Yes. Yes, it is a culture of overshare.
It's a culture of overshare.
The other day, I'm sitting in here. So typically, guys, I work from in this office space. This is a studio / office space. So we make it work, right?
Yes.
And I'm sitting there, and I'm on my phone, right? And I'm scrolling, and on Instagram. And excuse me, this was a first for me. Mm-hmm. And this chick, she had her phone. She's looking at her phone. I don't know what she was saying, but she acted like she dropped her phone. Okay. Right. So the phone drops. Mm-hmm. She steps over the phone. She has on like a skirt. She has nothing on underneath. So you can see her whole, real quick, right? It was real quick. Yes. And it was pierced. And then she picked the phone up and was like, oh, my bad, y'all. Ha, ha, ha. And then that was it. And I was like, this is where.
8 million views.
Yo. and then I wrote social media fatigue on the board. I'm like, where does it end? I don't know, man.
There is no shame. There is no embarrassment. There's no fear of your family. What impact your behavior might have on your family.
Nothing.
No repercussions, because everyone's trying to go viral and make money.
And that's the thing, right? So it ties into what we do, right? We're podding, mm-hmm. right? Now, I pod from a personal standpoint. I pod because I like to be creative. Mm-hmm. This is my way. This is my creativity
right now.
It's a creative outlet. I love this. And I love that we're able to do it together. Yeah. Right. We had great conversations. Yeah. And we're doing what we want to do.
Right.
Right. But here we are, episode 47. Right. And we're having conversations about how do we break through and get the ears of people outside of our immediate circle, because most people in our immediate circle are not supporting the podcast.
Absolutely.
Right. So, mm-hmm. So the way people break out is to go viral doing some bullshit.
Right.
And I'm not built like that. I know you're not built like that. Right. You're not going to sit on here with a champagne bottle and act like you know what I'm saying? Doing something. You're not going
to spray me like Dame Dash used to spray the women.
It's not happening. I got to clean this couch off. Yeah. I got to clean it. No, I'm not going to, you know what I'm saying, embarrass my wife or say something crazy.
But some people don't have that filter. They don't have it.
They don't. And then on top of that, and so they fit into it perfectly, because the reality is that's how you pop. Mm-hmm. We've seen people pop. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
The viral moment.
Now, so now you see, and shout out to her. You know what I'm saying? Shout out your girl, the gong chick.
Oh, don't call me white girl.
Don't call me white girl. Demona. Shout out to her. You know what I'm saying? Because she doing her thing, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that her moment, I don't know this, but I'm sure that her moment was just the moment that she was just wilding out. Mm-hmm. But now you see everybody trying to capture that moment in their own existence.
Yes.
Everybody is trying to have that same moment.
Yeah.
And it's crazy out there on social media, specifically on Instagram.
I mean, it's unfortunate. I mean, I understand people, there's a desire to also be famous. There is a desire for fame. People equate that with a better way of life.
Yeah.
People equate that with, again, monetary gain.
Yeah.
And they've seen other people have the success. So they feel like, hey, maybe I can have the same success.
Man, that's such a good point.
Maybe I can get that money. Maybe I can take myself out of the situation that I'm currently in and have a better situation. Maybe it can lead to other opportunities for me. Because we've seen people, they go viral. The next thing you know, they're on Ellen, or they're on Oprah's, or they're on any of these news stations. And then the next thing you know, they got a brand deal. And the next thing you know, they got a mansion and they're doing all of this.
It happens fast.
Offer a viral moment. Awful. And so people think that is the quick way to get famous, rich, and accomplish a status that they otherwise wouldn't have.
It actually is the quick way, but not for everybody.
It isn't
not for everybody.
It's like, that's like the 0.01% of people,
right? And man, you said some great stuff just now, like that, the whole fame thing. Yes. As we already knew, fame is they say it's the most addictive drug. Yes. Fame, right? And let me tell you something. I remember one time, right, I went out to I met with Mayo. Remember, mm-hmm. me and Mayo met up for drinks and stuff, whatever, yeah. that evening. And we went to this, wherever we went, was it that time? Wherever we went, the person working at the bar knew them. It wasn't the Colombian bar. It was somewhere else that we went. Mm-hmm. They knew him. And okay. It was like, and they introduced him to someone else as that, like, yo, this is the guy that blah, 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 somebody else in the industry. They had no idea who I was. Now, you know my background, Whiskey and Kicks, right?
You're the mayor.
No, I'm not. I'm not the mayor, right? Clearly, I'm not, because they know who the hell I was. Mm-hmm. And that moment, I was like, it made me think, it made me remember how popular I was in the community during that time. Like, I can go pretty much, it was a lot of bars I can just go into, and it was like, you know what I'm saying?
Everybody knew you.
It's discounts getting thrown out there, everybody. All those things. And that moment, I was like, wow, it made me remember that time. And it just made me think about how addictive fame is and how it could be. I was nowhere near famous, but, you know, on a lower scale, it's just like, wow. And it didn't make me think, I need to get that back so I can get that back. Nah. You know what I'm saying? That's cool. I mean, on a small scale, it's really manageable. But on a larger scale, people don't realize what fame can do to you. Mm-hmm. It could ruin your life.
We've seen artists yes. who have imploded.
Yes.
Because they have been famous and they couldn't handle the attention, the press, the following, the paparazzi. Look at Lauryn Hill. Look at Britney Spears. Look at people who really, Mariah Carey. People have had meltdowns.
Yes.
In the middle of the height of their fame.
Yeah.
Complete meltdowns because they were not prepared for that sort of thing, that sort of attention.
And look at the people who discovered and realized how toxic fame and a lot of money can be, like Jim Carrey. Yeah. And they make him look crazy.
Right, they make him look crazy.
They try to make him look crazy.
Mm-hmm. And some people who have attained the fame then decide to remove themselves.
Like Jim Carrey.
Yeah, become a recluse because you don't want it.
Yeah.
You're good. You're like, you know what? I'm good. I don't want it.
So yeah, I think I'm like with my off brand, my other brand, this Brocky Does thing, like I had the Whiskey and Kicks thing, mm-hmm. and I kind of still have it, right? But we've been talking.
Yes.
But we'll talk about that further another time. But the Brocky Does thing, right? It's like, I realized the other day, I don't want to share anything with anybody right now. Mm-hmm. I don't want to show people how I clean my sneakers. Because mm-hmm. I was going to make a whole thing out of that. I just cleaned mm-hmm. up 3 pairs of sneakers. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I was like, I started filming it. And then I just I don't feel like doing that. Mm-hmm. I don't want to do it. Mm-hmm. I really don't want to do anything with people on social media right now.
And it has absolutely nothing. It's actually healthy and very self-aware.
Yeah.
To find that space where you feel like that. I think I said to you when we were talking about the 6 months of sitting down, I said, you know, I've been thinking about a social media.
You did say that. Yep.
I've been thinking about walking away and just leaving the page where it is. And letting it do whatever it does. And me not really thinking about it for a portion of this 6 months of sit down that we're doing. Because I think that there was a point in time where I was becoming like, well, why didn't I get offered that?
Yeah.
Or how come I'm not, I should be doing that. Or I should, you know, like a lot of that stuff. And you start to examine the ego. You start to examine yourself, your self-reflection, and what are you really thinking about? And what is this really about for you?
Right.
And why are you really doing
right,
this?
Right, right. What is your, why? Like James would say, what is your why?
What is your why? And my why, I used to have like this great why, like when I was selling jewelry and all and doing wine and all those things. And it was like to bring more joy to my life.
Yeah.
More joy.
Yeah.
That was it. It was more joy. Because I had such an opposite experience. My work life was so bleh.
Right.
And I felt like any personal projects, any outside side hustles or anything that I did was supposed to be a passion and to bring more joy into my life.
That's key, yo.
And if it wasn't that, then I didn't need to do it.
That's how I feel. That's how I feel. That's why I stopped the whiskey and kick stuff at that time. Started doing something else. Like, Instagram is not going to make me rich. Not that I even desire to be rich.
It ain't monetized no more.
Instagram ain't giving me no money. Like, this is a creative outlet for me. And that's pretty much it. Mm-hmm. Now, we want to grow our podcast. Yeah. We want to get more. We want to reach more ears. Mm-hmm. Right? You know what I'm saying? So it's just a matter of how we do that. And we've been talking, and we'll continue to talk and plot that out and form things up and just realize how. But you will not see us out here shooking and jiving on a camera to get views, likes, subscriptions, or whatever it is that people try to get from shooking and jiving on a goddamn camera.
I'm not gonna be butt naked, y'all.
It's not happening. It's not happening. You know what I'm saying? And shout out to anybody out there who feel like they want to do it. And if it's something that's really bringing you joy and happiness, then knock yourself out. Yeah. Go ahead and drop your little phone and coochie squat over the phone. Go for it. If that makes you happy,
that's wild.
But Jesus Christ, I don't want to see that shit all the time. You know what I started doing recently?
You started liking more happy stuff.
I started liking happy stuff, yo. Yeah. Like, there's literally pages, like, some happiness. I don't know the name of the pages that I follow. But, like, shit, let me just see this monkey being happy to be reunited with the owner.
Yeah.
Or something happy and positive to balance out the bullshit, yo. I don't, as much as I, love women and as a man and all the other shit, I don't want to see that shit all the time.
I put in the hashtag Buddha and started following
Buddha stuff. You got to.
I do meditation. I follow yoga pages. I follow positive affirmations pages. I unfollowed the Shade Room last year. Yeah. I definitely was never following World Star.
Oh, God.
But I noticed that there were certain things, and I think we've tapped on this before. Don't sleep. They're pumping certain things into the black people algorithm that they're not pumping into other folks' algorithms. Okay, there are certain things, like, I don't want to see Krishan and Blueface, but damn it, why are they always on my explore page? I am 47. I could give two shits about what them two are doing.
You know, the way it works, it's like it's like staring up at the stars and seeing the constellation. Like, the stars connect. So you don't even have to really like their stuff. But if you like this stuff, or you look at this stuff,
so then you must.
Then it connects the line all the way down to that. You must like this shit too.
I mean, I like Love and Hip Hop, basketball wise. So then they're going to show me Krishan and Blueface.
Love and Hip Hop exposes you to all types of shit.
I watch a little Real Housewives of Atlanta, of Potomac, of New York City. And then the next thing I know, I'm seeing all this shit.
Yo, man.
So yeah. No, I got you. I understand. I totally. And that's why I said, I've been thinking about taking like a fast. I mean,
it's about to happen. Even with Where's Brunch? Like, listen, I know we post clips on Instagram and all that kind of stuff. But the reality is that people on Instagram stay on Instagram. People on YouTube stay on YouTube.
People don't TikTok. People
don't bounce. They don't. You don't post stuff on Instagram and expect a bunch of people to go over to YouTube to watch your full episodes. Those crowds are generally separate from each other.
Yes.
Right? It's only a few people that are bounced between. Yeah. So the people that listen to your podcast, they listen to your podcast.
Yes.
The people that watch on YouTube, they're going to watch it on YouTube. Yes. And that's it. So what I'm getting at is that people on Instagram. If y'all want to participate in this brunch crew situation, you might want to lock into YouTube. If you don't, like I said, if you don't bounce, you don't bounce. But there's going to be a period of time on the Instagram front that we're going to go a little dormant for a little while.
You're going to go dark.
It's going to go dark for a little while on Instagram, because Instagram is the one. It's the toxic. It's the most toxic shit. But here's the thing.
Think about it. When Instagram released Threads, 3 million people joined in the first 24 hours.
Yeah.
That means those are people who already had Instagram accounts.
Yes.
Because you can only join Threads if you have an Instagram account.
That's true.
It's directly connected. 3 million people
Yep.
joined.
Yes. Yep. I joined. I was one of them.
I was one of them too. Your number was lower than mine.
That shit lasts about a week.
But here's the thing. When I was on Threads, I've actually found different people that I was actually interested in following because I saw them on Threads in my feed. And I was like, well, who's this? Well, I don't follow this person. Let me go click on her Instagram page. I was like, she really does like the Hotel Whisperer. Shout out to the Hotel Whisperer. She posted something on Threads in this conversation about Black content creators and their influence and how, you know, she doesn't have a certain number of influencers, so certain brands might not necessarily want to work with her.
Right.
And I was like, let me go look at her page. I'm like, oh my gosh, she's like at all the hotels. The Hotel Whisperer, follow her.
Okay.
Not. But it,
shout
it
out to
just,
her.
Shout out to her.
Black girl. Okay.
Yeah. Just looking.
Double shout out.
At the Black content creators who I've found as a result of Black Girls and Trader Joe's rebranding herself to Black Girl In. She dropped the Trader Joe's.
Right. And Trader Joe, y'all should have done better.
Yes, they should have done better. Just the conversation that's going on Threads about the influence of Black content creators. It's a great conversation, and the breakout conversations that I've been able to follow and find people that I'm interested genuinely in to go and follow. I'm like, man, these are some cool people that I really want to follow that I can't find them on Instagram because the algorithm would rather give me freaking Blueface and Krishan.
I was wondering where you was going with that. But yeah.
Yeah, you see?
Yeah, yeah, it's crazy.
Quality conversations happening on Threads that I'm not going to see necessarily.
Well, I ain't going to see none of that shit in a minute.
Yeah.
For a little while.
Yeah, it'll be good.
Yep.
Sometimes you need those breaks. You know, I have social media fatigue, but I also have beach deprivation.
At the beginning, we have technically the 6 month shutdown. What was it called?
6 month sit down.
The 6 month sit down doesn't start until November 1st,
but
which
right
is next
now,
week. You're already talking about the beach.
I got beach deprivation right now.
Maybe we'll try to do that one day turn and burn thing that Joe did and Vic did it too. You know what I'm saying? That seemed to work out really well. I'll fly on
Spirit for it.
Money duh. Yeah.
Psych, Southwest. You know we can do it.
We can do Southwest. Psych. You lost right there.
Psych and mine.
I feel like I should call Joe to get him to explain that turn and burn situation.
Yeah,
that might
be
dope.
That'll be fun.
Let's call Joe real quick and see what happens.
Okay. Can I get a refill? Why am I getting me?
You've reached Joe Sampson, and I am.
All right, Joe ain't available. All right, so you ready to lighten the mood a little bit?
Let's lighten the mood.
Joe wasn't available, you know what I'm saying? I tried to reach Vic. Vic wasn't available. Okay. And I understand those last second. I didn't arrange these calls with these guys.
Yes.
So what you want to talk about?
So last week, Instagram was in a confuzzle of things.
Confuzzlement.
Because it was questionable as to whether this was staged or not. But a young woman was live, I guess, on her Instagram recording that she was going on a first date with a gentleman.
We hitting on this one. Okay, yeah. Gotcha.
Isn't that what we're talking about?
No, it's good. Let's go.
It's background.
Yeah, let's go. Let's
okay, so she's with this gentleman, they're going on a first date, and she is talking to her phone, and she's talking about, oh my gosh, this fool is trying to take me to the Cheesecake Factory for this date. And I don't understand this. I'm like she was like, I'm a high caliber woman, and why is he trying to take me
she
to the
can't
Cheesecake
be seen Factory? In there.
This is not what a first date should be, and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, what? And so then she talks to the guy. The gentleman's like, you know, she was like, I would have expected that we would have gone to a restaurant like such and such. And he shows her on his phone that he had a reservation for another destination. However, when he came to pick her up at said agreed time, it was an hour in and she wasn't ready. She
wasn't ready.
So they missed their reservation at the quote-unquote high-end restaurant. And so they were going to the Cheesecake Factory. And she refused to get out of the car.
Cheesecake Factory, which has an incredibly large menu.
Yeah, that menu is like 32 pages long.
You can get something out of Cheesecake Factory, yo. Don't front.
And let me tell you, those avocado egg rolls are the bomb.com with dipping sauce.
I feel like we're going to have to go there. You've been talking about them for the last couple days.
They are so good. Like, yes. Okay, so then as a result of that, you know how the folks are.
Interneted.
The internet was internetting, and they came up with these lists of things.
So what's this first list?
So the first list is first date. Here's a list of places women absolutely refuse to go on a first date. And thank you to the ladies who reached out to me to help me on this list.
Does it say who put the list together?
It doesn't say the Black Woman Delegation, so don't try.
I was just wondering if it was a woman or a man.
It's a woman who put the list together and said that women messaged her, and so she compiled
it. She probably beat up. Go ahead, though.
So we've got number one, the Cheesecake Factory. Number two, Applebee's. Number three, Chili's. Number four, Chipotle. Number five, Olive Garden. Six, the movies. Seven, your house. Now, I will say, I agree with that. First date should not be at anybody's house, just for safety.
1 through 7, I'm with so far. Like, Cheesecake Factory is cool, but Olive Garden, I don't go there myself. So I
haven't been in a long time.
You know what I'm saying? Like, those places I don't go to. My house, that would depend on the person and the situation. No, listen, Tree, you shaking your head, but I know we weren't quote unquote dating at the time, but you invited me to your house because to have dinner and talk about what we wanted to do creatively.
But I had already met you the week before.
But still, No, you hadn't. You hadn't met me in person.
Yes, we did.
No, you didn't. We hadn't. We met the first time.
The first time we met at the restaurant.
That's right. I was supposed to be at your house.
But we wasn't dating.
No, we weren't. But you still, it doesn't matter. We still were strangers, and you felt safe enough is what I'm getting at.
Right. I told you enough that I felt like it was okay.
Right. You felt safe enough. The point that I'm getting to is that someone could feel that level of comfort in trying to date a person. And if maybe he's a chef or some shit like that, and he set up something dope or whatever, you know what I'm saying? So that's an iffy one. And mostly people probably won't do that, but I could see how it could happen.
All right. So I said the movies and your house.
Okay. Movies no good.
Okay.
It's secondary. If it's a first date, movies like the second or third thing that y'all do, maybe.
Yeah.
But it's not a good first date.
Okay. So next, 8. Any fast food chain like McDonald's, Burger King, Wendy's.
We're assuming KFC. This list is for what, 35 and up?
Yes. Oh, wow. Buffalo Wild Wings, Wingstop, Red Lobster. I can't see that word.
What's Buffalo that? Wild Wings?
Yeah.
What if they're both diehard Redskins fans and the game is playing on Monday night and they want to go their first date? It could be situational.
Their wings are terrible, though.
Their wings are trash.
Okay. Next. Wait. You can't go on a date at a Wingstop? They got Wingstop.
No, Wingstop is a wrap. No, you're not going to Wingstop.
Wingstop? Who,
do people eat at Wingstop?
That's what I'm asking you. Can you have a
date? Can you even sit down there?
I didn't think you could sit down at Wingstop.
That's crazy. Well, Why would they even put that on there?
The one in Florida in Palm Beach Gardens, I think you can sit down and eat at that
Wingstop. Do they serve alcohol, too?
I don't think so.
I wouldn't go to Wingstop first date.
Okay, Wingstop, Red Lobster, pause.
Cheddar biscuits is crazy. Is crazy. Listen,
I don't know what you're talking about. Cheddar
biscuits are crazy.
They are crazy, okay? Somebody said a buffet.
I don't go to buffets anyway.
I've been to Golden Corral.
I don't do buffets, yo.
Okay, IHOP.
Yeah, I'm not going to IHOP for first date either.
Denny's. Now.
I don't go to Denny's. They racist.
The gym? Now, if y'all both fitness people, that might be a pretty cool thing.
Exactly.
Let me see how much you could bench press. Okay? Okay. Church? I don't know if I want to go to church.
For a date?
A date? That's not a date. The Lord is watching.
the Lord is always watching, y'all.
Okay, next, Starbucks. So I guess this is those coffee. Oh, and next is coffee dates.
Coffee dates? No, that is bullshit.
Because you know people were saying that guys, you want to go on the starter date, the pre-date with a coffee date to see if you're worth the money to invest in a regular date. I'm just saying that's what they were saying. Coffee dates are no. Ice cream dates.
Hold up. Let's not move on from coffee dates. Okay. There's some dope ass coffee shops out there.
There are. You can sit down. Alcohol or something.
What's the spot that both of us said we like? Open Adams Morgan.
Oh.
Come on.
Teism?
Nah, it's not Teism. I can't remember the name of it right now. Okay. But it's, you go inside, there's velvet sofas, all types of leather sofas everywhere.
Yes.
Everyone's in their own world. Yeah. You can go there and sit down and have the best conversation you've had in your life.
And you will get to know the person.
Be creative, people. Get the fuck out of that.
Coffee dates, ice cream dates, which I don't
even know what that is.
Ice cream date. Like just going get downstairs ice cream? To get That's ice cool. cream. What's wrong with that? You can walk in a park and have some ice cream.
Yeah.
Okay. Family functions. Now, I don't know about meeting family on the first date.
Not on the first date.
No, not on the first date. Okay. Movie night, which is Hulu, Netflix. That's Netflix.
That's Netflix and chill. Yeah, you just trying to get some ass.
That's your boinking.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-mm, or she trying to get some, you know what I'm saying?
Anyway, somewhere that requires a long drive. If he's a serial killer.
That could be kind of funky for a first date.
Yeah, stuck in a car. Depending
on how y'all know. Yeah.
And if you don't like them, and y'all don't mesh well.
That's like a mini vacation test.
Yeah.
Can you imagine driving all the way out to the winery we went to in Virginia?
On a first date?
On a first date? It's like you come in a car.
And you ask for some Moscato at the restaurant. Oh, my God. We got to go.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Me.
Just saying, if we was going on a date to a winery and you asked for some Moscato, I would be like, oh my gosh, I gotta go.
Gotta go. This shit is a wrap.
It's a wrap. Okay. Bowling. Come on. There's nothing wrong.
Bowling is fun.
That is fun. That is competitive. That's blood flowing. They got, chicken tenders and fries.
Yes. They only have good chicken tenders.
Yes.
And it has to be agreed upon by both parties because, as every man in this world knows, a black woman ain't gonna mess up her nails at the bowl now. And so you have to clear that with her
you
first.
You gotta make sure my nails are short, but I'm down to bowl. So let me tell you.
By the time you decide or agree to go bowling, you know it's a good idea already because she is down with it.
Okay. Nightclubs.
Nah, that's not a good date. That's not a good idea, period. At our age.
Hookah bar.
I don't know nothing about hookah. I don't do hookah shit.
Yeah, I've done hookah, and I don't think that's a date.
I don't think that's a good first date either.
A bar just for drinks.
No, that could be dope.
That could be cool.
That could be dope.
That could be a cool first date.
Yeah, that's corny. Like, somebody made that shit, that list or whatever. They probably live in, like, some town that don't have dope shit. Because there's a lot of dope-ass cocktail bars out
there. Waffle House.
That's not a good first date, yo. You can get in a fight.
I mean, Russell did just recently rent out a whole Waffle House for Sierra's birthday, and that was nice. But no.
And I'm sure, I'm not sure the internet.
She was craving it. She's pregnant.
She loves Waffle House. And I'm sure the internet have they been going crazy on her because she was so happy about it or no?
No.
That sounds like an internet thing to do.
It was her birthday.
And she loves the Waffle House.
Yeah, she loves it. She's pregnant. You know, all those things. Okay.
I love the Waffle House. It's fucking delicious, yo.
Hey. Sporting events. No. I would go. You want to take me to see the Knicks?
That's a dope ass first date.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
I want a hot dog. I want some popcorn.
I don't know why they would put that
wine.
There.
I want all those things.
That's stupid.
That was the first.
Oh, that's
part.
The whole list.
That's the whole list.
Okay.
And so
that
now,
was fun. I like that.
That was fun. And so now I got today, not too long ago.
Oh, there's more.
A good friend of mine, Calvin. Of course, has posted.
Oh, my man Calvin?
Yeah, my man Calvin.
Yo, shout out to my man Calvin.
We could call Calvin. I'm sure he would get on a call.
I know. He posted
the Ladies Strike Back, a new list of the men that have no business dating, period.
Well, how is this the Ladies Strike Back? The ladies made the first fucking list, but go ahead.
The ladies are telling you.
They're getting some more. They're piling on.
Because the men are going to try to tell us, oh, these women y'all ain't stupid. Trash. You want to tell us where we can't take you. So now the women are also letting you know, However,
let's go. I feel like I'm about to butcher this. What is it called again?
Ladies Strike Back, a new list of the men that have no business dating,
period. Oh my God, who are you to tell somebody they don't have no business dating? Okay. Go ahead.
Men with toddlers or younger.
Bullshit.
They need to stay their ass home.
No, that's bullshit.
Why?
You might not be with the woman.
A newborn?
You might not be with the woman.
You shouldn't be dating.
Why?
You just had that baby.
No, she just had the baby.
But you still involved in the situation with the baby? With
you're
the
not lady? With the baby 24/7.
But you should be doing more.
How you know? What if it's half and half?
Okay. Either way.
Which is never going to be, because no woman's going to give up their child half and half when the baby is newborn.
If it's a toddler, but no, if it's a toddler.
Yeah, if it's a toddler and the baby's a toddler, you're spending time with the mom. Yeah. Y'all clearly not together.
Yeah. I dated a guy who had a baby. The baby was like one, and he was so bitter, angry with the baby mama. I was like, I can't do this, because the energy here, I just can't do this. And you looking for somebody to help you take care of this baby. I'm good.
That's him. I was single with a toddler. I was walking to the mall with my son in one of those front carry shits. Right. Like, I was.
Was you picking up women?
What are we in the 50s?
I'm asking you, was you picking up women? Like, were you out? Was you pulling chicks because you had a baby in the thing?
Oh, no. I never did that when I had my son and stuff. Okay. But I'm just saying that was a time in my life when I wasn't cutting off my romantic life just because I had a young child. That nigga wasn't with me all the time. Yeah, go back to your mama, nigga. I got shit to do. You know. You already know. What'd you say when you dropped your kids off with your
It was hot single mom.
You was out of here.
But they were 10. They were 8 and 5. It was not the same. Can I get back to the list?
Go ahead, babe. Go ahead.
Men that live with their mama.
Go. Keep, you know what? I remember reading a little bit of this list. Keep going. I'm not gonna interrupt until a certain point. Go.
Men that live with their baby mama.
Keep going.
DL men.
Keep going.
Men that don't have a valid driver's license.
Keep going.
Men that bank with Cash App.
Keep going.
Men that sag their pants.
Keep going.
Men that don't take care of their kids.
Keep going.
Men that disrespect women.
Keep going, please.
Men that don't own a suit.
Keep going.
Men that live in motels.
Go.
Oh, my God.
Go.
Men that want to hold a couple of dollars till they get paid.
Let's pause for a second. Pause for a second.
Can I hold a couple of dollars till I get paid?
Let me tell you what this list is really about. Whoever's making this list or experiencing these things need to question why they're attracting those people. Why are you attracting a person who... What is it? Doesn't have a driver's license?
Well, you don't know that.
No. Black woman delegation. Don't try it, son.
You don't know the man's license.
You don't know. You don't. That's the whole concept of the laws of attraction. You don't know about the specific person. You just attract the type. And this someone is attracting all you. Did you hear how ridiculous those things were? You just read off, baby.
Come on, now, hold on. DL men. DL men, women don't know. You don't know.
But
you don't know. You can't even say that there's an energy if the man is being deceptive.
Running into it maybe once or twice in life is one thing. You are attracting. It's something that you are doing in your life that's attracting a nigga who's sagging his pants all the time.
But men with who bank with Cash App?
Men. Yes, this is the same guy who's sagging all the time. Yes. If those guys out in the street and they see you, they're not gonna approach you.
They're not gonna approach me.
They're not approaching you.
Oh, they're not approaching
because you don't don't attract that.
Nigga, what?
Keep going.
Okay.
This list is toxic as shit.
Men whose clothes are in tubs. Oh shit. Men that can't log into anything without her help. Without help.
That's okay. Hilarious. Let's go back though. Men with their clothes in the tub. Mm-hmm. Just to put a disclaimer.
I seen somebody post something on Instagram. He was like, don't at me. I just moved. My dresser hasn't arrived yet.
Listen, people in New York City store things in the oven. They have to. So let's not be too judgy.
Oh my God.
In New York City, you have to.
Shutting that nigga
You don't have space. They do that.
That's crazy.
Yes, they store things in their oven. So go ahead though.
Okay. Where was
hilarious, man. This shit is funny.
Men that gotta tell their mama everything. Men that work at the FedEx hub. Men that work.
Yo, FedEx is a good job.
Men that work at temporary service. Truck drivers.
That's not the bullshit. Truck drivers is bullshit.
Them grand rising men.
Mm-hmm. What is that? What does that mean?
Grand rising queen. They send you a text.
Oh, like, shit.
Grand rising.
Grand rising. Oh, Lord have mercy.
God. Hold on. They got it. The what you doing, men.
That's all they got to talk about. Yeah, what you doing?
Them what WYD. You doing, they send you the text.
All
what
the
doing.
Damn time.
Mm-hmm. Men with multiple kids and baby mamas.
Mm.
Men who bash women on social media. Men that have to load their card to add money to it. Men, men that don't keep their locks up.
Oh my goodness.
Men that hairline is gone and they keep holding on.
Mm.
Men that always talk about what they used to have.
Mm.
Married men. There's a thought.
Mm-hmm.
Men without transportation.
Who y'all attracted?
Men without transportation.
Mm-hmm.
Men that are Cowboys fans.
Oh yeah, y'all stupid. So that's funny.
That's both of my ex-husbands.
That's funny.
That's both of my ex-husbands.
Oh my god. Cowboys fans.
Both of them.
Hey man, listen. You know what I'm saying? Y'all saw what the 49ers did to them Cowboys recently. I'm sitting on this couch for a reason. Yo, that list is it's bullshit. I mean, it's all internet shit, of course.
It's all internet fodder. And but, everyone's going back and forth. The men are talking about the women ain't this. And the men are saying the women got unrealistic standards. Then you have the other folks. Then you've got the women posting them and their husband and their wedding attire saying our first date was at the Cheesecake Factory and all those types of things. There's just like so much stuff that's out on the internet now because everybody is all caught up in these lists and everything. And honestly, you just got to find the person who matches what you like. That's what the whole interview process, the dating process is about. You're finding the person who is your match.
And you have to be conscious of the energy you put out into the universe because whatever you put out there, you're going to attract that shit, right? Mm-hmm. So be conscious of what you're putting out there.
Yeah.
Because it's going to come right back to you in a form of a motherfucker who, you know, lives with his mama or sags his pants or whatever, or some chick with the dumb eyelashes that all she care about is how she look and so on and so forth. I mean, you got to be conscious of what you're putting out there because that's going to dictate what you attract.
It's serious. That's real serious.
It is very serious. It is funny. That was fun. You know what I'm saying?
That was fun. Shout out to in other messy news, shout out to Cam Newton, who his girlfriend Jazzy comedian, Jasmine Brown, announced that she is pregnant.
What's messy about that? That's his girlfriend. I didn't know
because this will be his eighth child and his third baby mama, and Cam has a record with these chicks about getting them knocked up and then skirt.
Oh, he's not taking care of the kids?
No, he does take care of the kids, but
he's not in a relationship with the chicks.
The mothers. The last one, I think she had four of his kids, and then at some point he put out.
Hey man, you gotta populate the earth. You know what I'm saying?
Is that what he's
saying? Mankind. This is the survival of mankind. You gotta populate the earth.
But shout out to Jazz. I mean, you secured the bag, honey.
Oh, secured the bag. Hey, as long as he's taking care of his kids and being a part of their lives, you know, I can't judge nobody, man.
And she is on her actual comedy tour. She was announcing tour dates.
She's a comedian.
She's a comedian. She's an Instagram comedian first, and then she blew up, and now she's on the road, and she's talking about, you know, I guess she's in her last trimester, and boom. She's the third baby mama, and she makes a joke about her being the third baby mama, and she's pregnant with Cam's child.
Well, you know, hey man, you know, so when you have unprotected sex, you have the possibility of getting pregnant.
Pregnant or itches and scratches.
You know what I'm saying?
Or something you can't get rid of.
I don't think Dwight Howard get nobody pregnant one time soon.
Ooh, child. Well, I mean.
He got kids though, right?
Yes, with Royce. I guess he,
oh, okay.
I guess and he Royce is. Tried to tell everybody when she was on Basketball Wives. Royce was on the first season. When he was with Orlando, I guess. Mm. Yeah, Royce was on the first season, his baby mama, and she talked about some things. And then he put a gag order on her, and she could not have their child on the show, and she could not mention him on the show because she was going to air it out, and she couldn't. He had lawyers and locked her down, but apparently it's all coming out now.
You know, everybody's going crazy on Dwight Howard for, you know, not coming out or whatever. And that's, you know what I'm saying, like being in the closet or whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. And that's in my mind, that's his right. Like, he can talk about his private life if he wants to. And if mm-hmm. he doesn't, then he don't have to. Like, it's nobody's business but his.
Yeah, your sexual activities are not.
Yes, your business,
but if
bro.
If you hurt someone or assault someone,
that's a legal thing.
And then it goes to court, then it kind of becomes public information.
Oh, it's public information, mm-hmm. but he doesn't have to answer to it or, right. you know what I'm saying, or anything. He has to answer to anything from a legal perspective, of course. Right. You know what I mean? But the internet, he doesn't owe the internet anything. Fuck them niggas.
He went on, he posted that whatever he does in his bed is none of our business.
Nobody's business.
But the gentleman, Mr. Stephen Harper, made a statement on Instagram in his stories the day before yesterday, advising his take on things because he doesn't want people lying on him and the situation that happened.
We don't even know you.
Hey, got it. We don't know him, but he said that people was lying on him, and so he felt like he needed to make a statement because he provided the receipts.
Fame is a hell of a drug.
Okay, well, I mean, you know, Dwight said he's not gay. He just is into freaky stuff.
You want to talk about what we're watching?
Yes, let's hit it.
The Where's Brunch podcast, as you can see, and here's what we're watching on TV.
Excuse me, partner. Can you keep that shit down? You see me watching TV.
Hey, rest in peace, Tupac.
Rest in peace, Pop.
Yes.
Beckham.
Yes. On Netflix, ladies and gentlemen.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. If you have not watched it, you might want to skip about, I don't know, 5 minutes, 7 minutes.
Whatever. Nah, yeah. Just tune in. Fuck it, man.
Yeah,
give
or you
minutes.
Can listen, but this will be a spoiler. We actually sat the other night and watched the David Beckham documentary on Netflix because it was highly recommended. And it was quite the eye-opener. I didn't know. I only know about David Beckham from his times of success and that he married Posh Spice. And right. they got these kids.
You knew he was a soccer player.
I knew he was a soccer player. And I remember when he started modeling shirtless and naked. And everybody was like, oh, David Beckham. Oh, okay. Black women were like, whoa, I'm going to watch a little football. Because David Beckham, you know, he...
All right. That's a sound. All right. That was a good sound effect. Oh gosh!
Like, all right, Posh Spice, we see you, girlfriend. We see you.
All right, you gotta relax over it a little bit. Relax a little bit.
So yeah, so it was a very eye-opening story about his foundations in soccer. Oh, I'm sorry, football, and his father, you know, coaching and challenging
I missed what
him.
The first what
the first episode.
First episode,
yeah,
I missed.
You came in on the second.
Okay,
and just how he signed with the league at a very young age. He moved away from his family.
So wait a minute. Go back. How was his dad with him? I missed that.
You know, making him practice.
Okay, so he was hard on him. Yes. Soccer.
Do it again.
So did his dad play soccer too?
It did not say that.
It didn't say that. Okay, gotcha. Okay.
He was like he worked or something.
Okay.
Remember when he was saying the corner kicks? Mm-hmm. And they were flashing back.
Yeah, okay, so that's who. Oh, so he was talking about his dad making him do those corner kicks over and over and over
and over and over and over.
That's why he was so good at it. Gotcha.
He was so good. And it just talks about his career. It talks about how he just one day happenstance watching TV or something, I think it was. And he saw the Spice Girls and he saw Posh Spice and he told somebody, I'm going to marry her.
Wow.
Just like that.
Wow.
And then what happened was Posh Spice and Sporty Spice came to one of his games. Mm. And they came to, you know, witness the football game. And at that point, he kind of interacted and followed up. And he was in love. He was smitten. He was like, this is it. This is the person for me. And it was just a series of him doing crazy shit, like chartering planes from where he was doing soccer practice to go meet with her. Mm. Just to spend a couple hours with her and then come back.
Word. Okay. Dope.
And so her career is on the rise as a Spice Girl in the 90s. His career as a soccer player is on the rise. His only dream in life was to play for Manchester United. That was his life's goal, and he did it. He was playing for them. Then he played for England for a minute. They went through the whole thing and the
issues. This is all public knowledge. This is all information that's out there, but they did a good job at telling the story.
And then he, at some point, was sent to Real Madrid, and then it kind of goes kind of left.
Yeah, he, you know, and it really does a good job at showing his passion for the sport and his passion for his family.
His family. He loved his family. Like, they had little Brooklyn, and they had Cruz, and I forgot all the kids' names. But, He spoke about how his order was soccer, family, and I can't remember priorities were those two things. And then at some point it flipped to family and then soccer after, you know, he had some little situations.
But if you're watching this documentary, I mentioned this yesterday, this undercurrent that it tells is Posh and how she kept the family together. Like, she really reared the children. She really she focused on their schooling. Mm-hmm. She focused on the things that are important to her, was not displacing the children and just uprooting their family at any given moment, because he was a football player, soccer player, and he had to move. He had to move at different, and he was making decisions based on his career.
Yep.
And it's like, yo, we gotta go. And she's like, whoa, you go.
I gotta get these kids in school. We need a house.
Yeah, yeah.
All these things.
So shout out to her for that. That's what I'm getting at. You know what I'm saying?
Her wifely duties.
Yeah, she was crushing it. And motherly duties.
Because it's not easy. I mean, you know, it's funny that you say this, because that's a topic in Jada's book. But we'll come back to that. So he gets traded to Real Madrid. Posh does not come immediately because the trade happened in like, what, 18 hours or something? And then he was supposed to be
moving tomorrow.
We're moving tomorrow. And so she needed time to set up a house and do all these things. So he was in Madrid for a while alone.
Yeah,
a few months until she actually got there with the kids and got them in school and all these things. And he was suffering bouts of loneliness.
Yeah, his teammate rallied around him.
His team tried to rally around him, which was Ronaldo and
all those guys.
And at some point, it came out that possibly he had stepped out on Posh.
Mm-hmm.
Possibly there was a relationship, an affair. And it made the cover of the papers.
Yeah, the media went crazy with it.
So I did a little digging, because I wanted to see what did Beckham do. Because it kind of, it's like this thing that they kind of talk about in the documentary, but they never give the specifics.
In the documentary, yes, they.
It's like this thing that happened to them. There was this thing of an affair.
Right.
And David doesn't confirm nor deny it.
Nor does she.
But they just talk about how they really had to work through it.
Through that whole period of time.
Because the press was.
And like, he specifically says, our private life is our private life.
Yes. Private life is our life. So I did some digging, and apparently he had an assistant. And him and his assistant were captured at a club in Madrid at night, out together.
Okay.
Said assistant apparently came forward and said that she had slept with him on more than one occasion. Mm-hmm. She went to oppress and did that. However, she also said that she caught him in bed with another woman. Mm-hmm. So I guess her, what's the word? When she did, they checked to see how reliable, trustworthy.
Right, okay.
There's a question about the validity of her statements.
Okay.
Or whatever. And then he fired her and him and Posh stayed together. And that's the end of the story. So there you have it.
I respect how they handled that.
They handled it. They didn't go into anything. They were just like, until this happened. And it was just about the press.
Exactly.
And then putting the story out and all these things. They never even said it was the assistant. They never said all of that. I had to go to Business Insider and the Galaxy paper and some other places to look it up to even find out.
You know, all you had to do was hit up the Black Woman Delegation headquarters and they sent you a whole email with attachments.
Anyway, so yeah, I did look it up. But it was interesting to talk about the issue of fame and celebrity, mm-hmm. because Posh was a big star, mm-hmm. and there was a time when David messed up on a kick and they lost the title of a game, and at that time I think she was pregnant and all these things, and they were sending him death threats. The country was like, they hated him. He was the worst soccer player in the world. And yeah. he left and came to the United States and went on tour with the Spice Girls as like the plus one to Posh while they were touring around the U.S. And she was like, I didn't even realize how bad it was until she came back to London and she saw the newspaper covers and all the hatred that was towards him. And it was a really dark time for him.
This in the doc?
That's in the doc.
I missed that.
You missed that part. They talk about the kick that he missed.
Yeah.
And the hatred that the country turned on him and how he constantly felt like he had to vindicate himself and get the win back.
Right, right.
For the country.
Okay, I remember that part.
Okay, you saw that part. Yeah. So, but in between them, when Posh would come to games, they would chant horrible things like Posh likes to take it up the ass. Like
Oh my God. They would say that shit during the games. That's right.
They were chanting it while she was there. They had all these horrible slogans that they were saying. And she was just like, she didn't realize, you know, she wasn't a football fan. She just loved watching him play. But just how uncomfortable. He said he was even uncomfortable playing and noticing the horrible shit that they were saying about her in the stands.
Soccer crowds are some of the most disgusting crowds in
racist.
Sports.
The European FIFA system is different.
Disgusting.
When the first child was born, they threatened to kidnap the child.
This is beyond.
They threatened to kill the child. All these things. She said she was so paranoid. She was so scared for the safety of herself and the baby because of the horrible things that people were saying just in the press or just chanting and saying things in the beginning. And then when he came back and they won, then all of a sudden they're celebrating him again and they love him.
This is a beyond spoiler alert.
I'm sorry. Four episodes.
It's good. It's really good. And funny enough, as much information as Trina gave you guys,
there's more.
There's a lot more. There's a lot more. It's worth watching.
It is.
For sure. Yeah. We have to perfect this. What we're watching, we be giving it away, yo.
It was so damn good. We were sitting here like, yeah. Oh shit.
Yeah. Like, I was locked in.
It's really, really good. It's really, really worth it. Watch it. It's on Netflix, and plus Netflix raising the price on everybody. So right. Y'all need to get the most you can get out of these dollars.
Right.
Goddamn
right. Good doc. Very good doc.
Yes, very good doc. So we did tap on a little bit. I did mention Jada's book.
Mm-hmm.
I am actually on chapter. There's 24 chapters in a book, I believe.
Uh-huh.
Oh, hell no, you didn't.
What happened?
She won't. No, she don't. the hell wrong with you? I'm gonna need y'all to stop coming for Jada the way y'all coming for her. It is not necessary, okay? It is not necessary.
Oh, go ahead, go ahead.
Let this woman tell her story.
Tell your story, yo.
More black women need to be able to tell their stories. We don't have enough black stories. Most of these authors and most of these stories that we're hearing are non-black stories. So you get a celebrity that y'all kind of asked for her to tell the damn story. And now she's telling the story and y'all acting like y'all don't want the story. So anyway, I listened to the story. I'm on chapter 17 of the story. I'm not finished yet. There's 22 chapters. I'm on 17. And it's been quite eye-opening for me to listen to this. And also, let me say that she announced that the book is number 3 on the New York Times bestseller list.
Shout out to her, man. Good for her.
So all
and Will.
And Will. Them,
and the whole family.
So all
they're all together on this shit.
All y'all little 1-star ratings and your hashtag entanglement. Oh, no, no. Ratings.
Explain that. Okay, you said that there was a movement.
There was a movement on Amazon, I believe, and a few other sites where people were going to bomb the book with 1-star ratings. 1 stars. People were commenting hashtag entanglement, hashtag this is the worst book I've ever read, this is a horrible book, narcissist, all the things.
Mm-hmm.
So as I was saying, I'm on chapter 17 of the book, and I've learned so much from her upbringing in Baltimore to the influence of her maternal grandmother raising her and her paternal grandmother, the issues with her mom being a heroin addict, a high functioning heroin addict.
That's serious trauma right there.
All of the trauma to her even bonding with Will over traumas.
Yeah.
At the time, what I thought was really, really important was that she had a mental breakdown right before she got into the relationship with Will. And she was on Prozac, and she was buying a country barn back in Maryland to move back here and leave Hollywood.
From where? Hollywood, okay.
To leave Hollywood and move back to Maryland to get out of the Hollywood lifestyle because she wasn't about it.
Right.
She felt like she had had her different world success. She had done Jason's Lyric. She had done Menace to Society. She had done some projects. But she felt like that Hollywood thing,
it wasn't for her.
Like, she realized. She could see. And he called her. And she jumped right into the relationship with him while he was in the middle of his divorce from Cherie. And she took herself off of her antidepressants. And that was not prescribed. She did it because she thought that being in love and being in a relationship with him would just cure everything. And she never finished addressing her issues. And so right now, the book is just dealing with the journey of you had a depressive breakdown. You were suicidal. You hop into a relationship. You get pregnant once, twice. You get married, even though you don't really kind of believe in getting married. You don't even want a wedding. And then you're thrust into this role of being a wife, a mother, a home, all of these things. And you're just like figuring out on the fly as you go.
Good reads. So far. It's an audio book.
It's great. She addresses the Hollywood rumors about them being swingers.
Okay.
She addresses Scientology. Rumors about Scientology. She talks about her father and him getting clean by attending some Scientology teachings. She talks about how she refused. She told him from the jump, I'm not joining Scientology. I'm learning about what your processes are. And most of her foundation is from her grandmother, who was an alumnus of Howard University, who traveled the world, who did all of these things, who learned about all these religions and teachings, and instilled that in her at a young age, which made her more inquisitive about religions and all that. She talks about the school. She talks about homeschooling the kids.
Okay.
She talks about how, you know, everybody talked about them not putting the kids in school and why she did it. And right now I'm at the point where she's in her ayahuasca.
Okay, nice, nice.
Yeah, she's in her ayahuasca thing right now.
Okay.
So I think that it is a very good book. I think the Tupac thing is highly oversold to people. I think that they talk about him maybe two chapters, maybe three, but he's not the focus. They were childhood friends, and she was very clear that there was no romantic connection at all with mm-hmm. them. She does talk about the letter that he wrote her about, let's get married. It wasn't a face-to-face thing. Mm-hmm. It was a letter that he wrote her about it.
Giving it away, yo.
I'm sorry. But just the misconceptions. She also talks about allowing false narratives to play about her.
Right. I mean,
and not defending herself.
Right.
Which is wild to me because she comes off as such a strong woman. She's tiny. She's 5 feet. She's all these things, and she's like a no shit taker. She talks about the drugs and selling drugs in Baltimore and the things that she did and how she got robbed and how she got set up and all these things. And she's always had this strong stance, and the softening of her took a while, but the narratives that she's allowed to just play out because she's A, protecting Will, A, B, protecting their image or whatever. And I'm like,
and C, capitalizing off of those narratives
to that sell part too,
right?
Because here we are.
Yeah.
Very, very interesting.
Yeah.
Very.
I mean, another interesting thing is just how we see how this the whole rose from the concrete kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like I'm listening to Rich Paul's book right now,
okay.
And this again another story of my mom was on drugs. My dad taught me how to gamble. My dad taught me how to be a hustler.
Wow.
All those things that creates this like superhuman.
Gotcha.
Good times don't create superhumans.
Right.
Hard times do. That's another topic.
Interesting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting.
That's another topic.
Yeah.
For another episode. Because we're about to go eat.
Absolutely.
So.
Absolutely.
So yeah, thanks for sharing that.
It was great. I mean, because I lived in Baltimore for
yeah.
a little bit. So she mentioned things that she's only 5 years older than me. So the stuff she was talking about, I was like, I know exactly.
Yeah, no doubt.
I know exactly
no doubt.
Where she was. No oh doubt. My goodness. But only in accounting stuff. I was never in the city. I was never in the hood. It was mm-hmm. none of that stuff. But very good listening. I think that people would be grossly surprised if they listen to it, that it's not the sensationalism that's going around. But I understand you got to do it to sell the book.
Yeah, yeah. You go into that knowing that a part of the crowd that participates in your rollout mm-hmm. are going to be completely turned off. And then you're going to have a bunch of people that's going to go out and get the book and listen to the book.
You know what I'm saying?
That's the way it goes. Like, it's fine.
I've loved Jada from since A Different World. I've loved her. I've rode for her. Y'all know I ride for Jada Pinkett Smith like all the time. Like
yeah, we know this.
I ride for Jada, and I'm not gonna stop riding for this. Her. But I just thought it was really good to hear her story and hear her take on it.
That's what's up.
Yeah.
That's what's up. Thanks for sharing your experience with the book, and I'm sure you're gonna finish that up in the next few days.
I am gonna finish it up in the next mm-hmm. few days. Mm-hmm. Listen, holla, Audible, Amazon. Get your Audible on. Now. Holla for Audible. I got Pinky's book. What's her name? Slutty Vegan's book. I Hope You Fail. Is next on my reading list. And I think Sheila Jackson Lee's book on becoming a black female billionaire. I'd love to hear. I want to hear her story.
Dope. Good stuff, man. Good stuff.
Yes. Do we hit everything?
Good episode. We are rapping. I don't care if we hit everything or not.
Okay.
This is a wrap. It's time to let the people go tend to their gardens and their children's.
Water your plants,
people. Don't neglect your plants out there.
Don't neglect your plants.
I think it's time for another plant soon.
Where we gonna put it?
There's somewhere to put it. So yes, this is your boy Brocky.
Nah, I'm Trina Marie,
and we are the Weird Brunch Podcast.
Hey,
y'all be good.
Y'all be great.